and gentlemen. My name is Saitsu. I'm a member of the Board of Directors and of the Advocacy Committee. On behalf of the Los Angeles Chapter of the National Council of Jewish Women, I'd like to welcome you to today's very timely Advocacy Committee program. Our organization employs a staff of dedicated professionals that provide vital community services for women and children. Our membership, however, consists of hundreds, thanks to Maya, of volunteers who devote their time to helping improve the quality of life for women, children, and families in our community through activism and education. Accordingly, today's program is being hosted by our advocacy committee, a knowledgeable, handsome panel has been assembled to shed light on the 17 state ballot measures that we will be asked to approve on November the 8th. Since many of these ballot measures are very complex, very controversial, and have serious implications for our future, the panel's guidance will hopefully assist us in making informed and intelligent decisions on election day. And that'll help when you get the 240 book that the state is distributing, because that gives you carpal tunnel. Okay. And our moderator today, Sandra Fluke, is a graduate of Cornell University and cum laude. I'm supposed to swallow it.
Yes. Okay.
Sandra is a graduate of Cornell University and a cum laude graduate of the Georgetown University Law Center. She describes herself as a social justice attorney and has devoted her career to progressive causes. She gained national prominence in February 2012 when, after testifying before a committee of House Democrats in favor of insurance coverage for birth control, she was slandered nationally by Rush Limbaugh. He was widely criticized and subsequently apologized, but she made the cover of the 2012 spring issue of Ms. Magazine. She's been involved for the last decade or two. She's currently a member of the National Council of Jewish Women Los Angeles Board of Directors, a pro bono attorney, and an activist for progressive causes. Before I turn the gavel over to Sandra, I have three brief announcements, please. On your chairs, you will find a card for written questions at the end of the panelists' discussion. There will be a program evaluation form for you to turn in, and you have a pen and paper for recording your vote preferences on the paper that lists each of the initiatives. Secondly, there will be an advocacy training project on September 23rd called How to Get Appointed to a Board or Commission. It's a $15 fee that includes light refreshments on a Sunday from 2 to 5. Sandra is one of the people that sometimes leads one of these. They're wonderful programs. Third, there will be a screening of the film called Trap. Trap is a documentary about the many restrictive laws that have been passed by conservative state legislatures attempting to limit and nullify Roe versus Wade. I think so far there are 280 of these kinds of laws. However, in June 27th by a vote of 5-3. The Supreme Court ruled in Whole Women's Health against Hellerstadt, Texas could not place restrictions on the delivery of abortion services, which created an undue burden for women seeking the right to choice. And on that note, ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce a friend, an advocate, and a moderator.
Thank you so much, Ruth. Ruth is such an incredible force here at NCJW LA on all of our advocacy efforts. And we also want to acknowledge and thank Maya Paley, who is our director in this area, who did an incredible amount of work to put together today's program. And thank you to all of you for taking some time out of your day to come and get some information on these ballot measures. These are incredibly important votes that we cast that have consequences for millions of people's lives, and too many citizens are not taking the time to find out and are legitimately confused and not casting the most informed votes. So just thank you for being willing to take that time and to really live up to your responsibilities as a voter. Thank you all for being here. So you have a few materials on your chairs. The first one I would direct you to is this one that has a list of all of the statewide ballot propositions. So we have statewide ones, and then we have local ones that vary depending on what city and county you live in. This is the statewide ones, and it has a little bit of an area for notes after each ballot measure. So I would just encourage you to take notes because there's a lot to keep track of on these. You also have, and this is just for fun, because some of us have a lot of fun with ballot measures, you also have haikus of all of the ballot measures. Now, I did not write these, and I do not do poetry, but I think it's pretty amusing. So they are actually helpful in helping you to remember what each ballot measure does. They're very informative as well. And then, I think lastly, you have the NCJW recommendations on a couple of ballot measures. This longer sheet is the statewide NCJW, and then you have a smaller sheet regarding a local measure that the Los Angeles section of NCJW has taken a position. Now, there's just a few that NCJW has taken a position on, as you can see. That doesn't mean that they're opposed to all of the other ones. It just means these are the ones that NCJW has prioritized, is actively doing work on, has voted to take a specific position. So you're going to hear about a lot of other ones beyond those few today from all of us up here. And our aim is, as NCJW in providing this program, is to provide information. We're not taking a position either way on the others, but you'll hear from folks who are very informed on these measures and have a specific position, but they're speaking on behalf of their individual organization or themselves personally. Does that all make sense?
Yes.
Great. Buckle up, we're in for a roller coaster ride, folks. So there are 17 measures on the ballot. I'm going to start off by introducing the panelists who are going to be helping to explain all of them. To my immediate right is Rosemarie Molina. Rosemarie is a leader in the fight for social justice for working class communities of color. She actually began her career in this area with the Clean Car Wash campaign that many of you may be familiar with. She was a leader on the LA Raise the Wage campaign, got LA's minimum wage to $15, and that's created ripples all over the state and the country. And she currently works in the dynamic movement building efforts of the Community Coalition in South Los Angeles as their Civic Engagement Coordinator. She works there to empower residents to utilize their political power to bring equity and resources to the systematically underserved region of South LA. So thank you so much for being with us, Rosemarie. Next down the line, we have Zachary Hoover. Zachary is the Executive Director of LA Voice, which is a multiracial interfaith organization of 55 congregations across LA County. Any of you who are involved with your temple or your church or your mosque can have a lot of respect for anyone who organizes 55 different houses of worship, right? He's also one of the members of the Guiding Council for PICO National Network. He's an appointed member of the Los Angeles County Probation Commission. And he's led organizing campaigns that have had the impact of dismantling unfair car impound policies affecting immigrants, increasing access to jobs and rehabilitative services for formerly incarcerated Californians, increasing public accountability for reinvestment by major financial institutions, increasing voter participation in communities of color, and bridging gaps between communities often divided by race, class, and geography. And on top of that, he has a 15-month-old son. And finally, we have Stephen Rohde. Stephen is a constitutional lawyer, lecturer, writer, and political activist. He is the immediate past chair of the ACLU Foundation of Southern California, our local ACLU here in Los Angeles, chair of the Death Penalty Focus, a founder and chair of Interfaith Communities United for Justice and Peace, and chair of Bend the Arc, a Jewish Partnership for Justice, an organization that NCJW frequently works with. Please also welcome Stephen Rohde. Now, I know you can't wait a moment longer to dive into these ballot initiatives, so let's get started. We're going to try to go in order of the numbers on this sheet so that you can follow along, and we'll bounce around a little bit between panelists which ones we're talking about. So I get the pleasure of starting off with the first few. Now, Prop 51 is something you might all be familiar with, a bond. You've voted on bonds before at the local and state level. This is a bond to provide funds to do renovations and modernize, as well as do construction of new facilities for schools, both K through 12 schools and also community colleges. It also has some funds for technical schools that teach trade tech skills, as well as some charter schools. Now, most folks are in favor of this one. It has overwhelming support. The concerns that have been raised are that the way a school district or a community college would apply for these funds is they'd put in an application and the state would review it and they would get the funds. Now, the school districts that are most equipped to put in that kind of application are the ones that already have some resources. Probably the better funded school districts that don't have as many challenges or are really on top of their game, and they're probably going to have the best chance of getting access to that funding. So the governor has actually said that he doesn't love that about this ballot measure and would rather that the funds were structured in a different way. He also thinks that the developers and construction companies are very supportive of this because it will create business for them. Now, those are the concerns. What I would say for me personally is that there is a great need for funding for construction of schools and modernization of schools, and I think that's why the vast majority of folks are encouraging you to support this measure. Now, if you have questions, just jot them down on that note card. We're going to take questions at the end just so that we get through everything. Okay? Now, Proposition 52. This one also is overwhelmingly supported. Many folks are encouraging yes votes on Prop 51 and Prop 52. Basically, what this says is that we want to continue a program that is largely seen as working. The program charges hospitals a fee, and then that money is used to match the money that the federal government gives us for Medi-Cal services, for Californians who need access to discounted medical care. And so this allows us to get more of those federal dollars brought into California because we have the funding to be able to match them, meeting that federal requirement. There was one particular union that had some concerns, and their concerns were about that there wasn't a lot of accountability about how the funding would be used, but they've actually stopped their campaign at this point. So this one is overwhelmingly, folks are supporting it because it brings more Medi-Cal funding into California. Proposition 53, the third one down. This one is highly, strongly opposed by a lot of folks. So this was put on the ballot by a gentleman named Dean Portopassi, who is a very wealthy farmer and food processor. In the area of California where the Delta water tunnels are being talked about, folks have heard about the Delta tunnels that the governor is proposing. And what the ballot says is that if there's a certain type of bond, what's known as a revenue bond, that is over $2 billion, it would have to be approved by the voters. Currently, these bonds can happen through the legislature and through the governor. So this is saying these types of bonds would have to go to voters, so it would mean more ballot initiatives. Some of the concerns are that it would mean that folks statewide are voting on things that are really projects that only impact one part of the state. So if you had a local government that wanted to work with the state to do some infrastructure work to get a bond to fund that, you don't necessarily want the whole state to be voting on whether or not Los Angeles should or should not take that step. That's one of the criticisms. It wouldn't apply to a ton of projects because of this $2 billion limit. Right now, it would really impact the Delta water tunnels and the governor's high-speed rail program. So this is seen as a way to try to kill those two programs. So we probably have a variety of opinions about the Delta water tunnels and about high-speed rail, but this would have lasting consequences because it would mean voters would have to approve all of these types of infrastructure projects going forward. That makes sense? This one's a little bit complicated. If all of these are going to be majority vote in terms of what the voters have to do. There's something complicated around how the legislature could change this, and that's probably what you've seen. But yes, it's majority vote to pass. So for me personally, I'm planning to vote no on this one. Okay, Proposition 54, the last one from me before we move on to Rosemarie. Proposition 54 was put on the ballot by Charles Munger. Have folks heard about Charles Munger? He's one of the largest conservative funders of political campaigns in California. Somewhat unlikely bedfellows, this measure is also supported by the League of Women Voters and Common Cause, good governance groups that aren't always on the same side of things. So what this one says is that legislation has to be in writing and posted on the internet for 72 hours before the Assembly or the State Senate has their final vote on it. So we're not talking about committees and all of those things, but before the floor of either house of the legislature takes their final vote. And normally, legislation is in writing for a long time before that. It takes about 9 months to get through the legislative process. But sometimes there are deals cut at the last minute, and things are amended, sometimes amended significantly. And the way the system is right now, there are ways that those amendments happen just a few hours before the vote. And you don't necessarily get to see a lot of the details of the legislation before our representatives vote on it. So on the surface, that sounds like a pretty good idea, that we would have a few days to take a look at it and know what's there and be able to call our representatives and say, I think you should vote for this, I think you shouldn't vote for this. The downside, the reason some people have concerns, is that that means that all of the special interests in Sacramento would also have 3 days to make those calls. And sometimes what's happening with those last minute changes is that a deal has been able to be brokered between different types of concerns and different factions. And if you give 3 days for all of those factions to weigh in and all of those special interests to weigh in, the deal might fall apart. So this is, I think, not a super clear one which way is the best approach. But that's what you have to decide, is whether or not you think that it should be in writing for 72 hours, and whether you'd rather give the members of the legislature more of an ability to come up with the sort of last minute deal. The other pieces of this are a requirement that all proceedings of the legislature be videotaped and made available online, which frankly, most of them are available and videotaped now, but this just clarifies that. And that those videotaped recordings can be used by anyone. So you will probably see a lot more advertisements during campaigns showing footage of what someone said on the floor of the legislature, positively or negatively. So that's the situation on that one.
Clarification, yeah. After, okay, so 72 days,
they got you, 72 hours. Yes.
It can still be changed. No matter, it's not final at 72 hours.
You can change a bill at any point,
right?
But it needs to be stable and unchanged for 72 hours before that last vote. And the way the California legislature works is that there are deadlines after which you can't take a vote. So you would have to have your legislation finalized 72 hours before the cutoff.
Well, then what's the adverse effects of people being...
Please, can you actually please write your question on
the card? Yeah, I think we're gonna have to hold more conversation on that until the end. But write it down on the card, okay? Okay. Rosemarie, can you tell us a little bit about Proposition 55?
Sure can. How's everyone doing today?
Good.
So Proposition 55 is essentially an extension of Proposition 30. Who remembers Prop 30 from 2012? So I'll give you a little refresher. So Prop 30 in 2012 imposed a tax on the highest earners in California. So if you earned $250,000 or more, you were getting taxed an additional 1% on your income. And if you earned $1 million or more, you got taxed an additional 4%. It also imposed a sales tax. People voted yes overwhelmingly for Prop 30. Where the money went was directly to education, to K-12 education, to community colleges, and to Medi-Cal. What we did after Prop 30 was also work in an equitable formula, sorry, I can't speak today, so that schools who were the highest need got more resources from that particular pool of funding. So it has worked, to say the least. We have seen the gap, the funding gap, close dramatically, especially here in Los Angeles and LAUSD because of the funding from Prop 30. So what Prop 55 does is it extends that tax. It doesn't increase it, it just continues it beyond the 2018 deadline until 2031, and it's estimated to generate about $9 billion annually for education. LAUSD has already come out and said if we do not pass Prop 55, we are seeing dramatic budget cuts. And let me share with you what that means for South LA, the community I work and live in. So right now, South LA schools are doing much better than they were before 2012, but we still have some schools who only have one restroom open for the entire population. Reason being, they don't have enough staff, enough yard duty to supervise other restrooms. They don't have enough money for toilet paper and basic essentials to keep in the bathroom. So this is a really serious proposition for us, and that this funding we cannot live without. So again, it's not an increase in the tax, it's an extension of what's already on the books, and it would end in 2031. It would also remove the sales tax from this measure, so remove the sales tax.
So then the only tax that's left is the one that is called the millionaire's tax, right?
Yeah, it was originally called the millionaire's tax.
Yay!
So I think one of the most groups are for this. Again, there's overwhelming support for Prop 55 because we can see immediately what it's going to do, how it's going to help, and how our students need it across LAUSD. The only concern is from Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association that it was supposed to end in 2018, let it end in 2018. But we definitely at Community Coalition are voting yes, along with California Calls, a coalition of 21 statewide organizations.
And just for context, Howard Jarvis opposes pretty much anything that's any tax in any way. So that's a fairly standard type of opposition. And this is the first one that we've talked about that NCJW has taken a position in support. So NCJW is supporting Prop 55 and encouraging folks to vote yes. Okay, Zach, can you tell us a little bit about Prop 56?
Yes, I can. Is this on?
Yes.
Good. And we're also supporting 55 and part of that larger coalition. So, okay, so 56. Oh, and I need to say hi to Sipra Nimeth from ICAR, who's a member of LA Voice, and also Judy from Beit Shuva, which is also a member of LA Voice. Okay, so 56, which is the first one I'm going to share about, is the California Healthcare Research and Prevention Tobacco Tax of 2016. We've seen tobacco taxes on the ballot before. Some of you may remember this one from almost 11 years ago. There was a tobacco tax on the ballot that actually failed that would have fully funded kids' healthcare in the state. So what this one does is it increases our cigarette tax by $2 per pack. We are about in the middle of the country in terms of tobacco tax right now on cigarettes. We're not at the top, like some folks will tell you. And it also, for the first time, will put that tax, it extends that tax to additional nicotine products, including e-cigarettes, which weren't around last time we were working on a tobacco tax. So it's supported by the American Cancer Society, and the Cancer Action Network and the American Lung Association in California, and of course the American Heart Association, because there's a direct correlation between teen smoking dropping and increases in the taxes on cigarettes and on e-cigarettes as well. So that's the first thing that it does. So if you look at the messages online on the 56 campaign, the first one is about protecting children because of that drop in teen smoking. There's also just, you probably know this, you've probably seen this in your own families or your own communities, but the attempts of the tobacco companies to now get kids onto nicotine through the candy-flavored e-cigarettes is a big thing that's happening across the state, well, across the country, actually. So the second thing that it does is puts the majority of this funding into the current healthcare system, including cancer research, specifically for cancers that are caused by tobacco products, and let's see here, what was the third point I wanted to make? Yeah, no, I think that's it. I'm trying to keep it brief because I know we have a lot to get through. So, and I know that you'll ask additional questions. The other thing I'll add that's not in the ballot, but that is important to many of us who also care about extending health care to undocumented Californians, is that one of the reasons we haven't been able to fully extend health care to undocumented Californians in the way that we have to undocumented children is because the pool of money is not big enough. This doesn't go to that, but it does create a larger pool of healthcare money in the state, which we think, for those of us who want to see that happen, would be advantageous for our fights down the road. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Zach. Okay, back to Rosemarie to talk about Proposition 57.
So Proposition 57 does two interesting things. The first is that it repeals parts of Proposition 21. Who remembers Prop 21? Prop 21. So what this did is it gave power to prosecutors instead of judges in situations of juvenile crime. So right now as it stands, if you are a juvenile between the ages of 14 and 18, you commit a certain crime or a certain amount of crimes, a prosecutor gets to decide, not a judge, whether or not you go directly to adult court and into adult prison. You know, we've seen the effects of this in South LA pretty heavily. It's also a lot cheaper to send a kid to adult prison than to pay for them to go to juvenile hall, where they'll get medical attention and education and all that stuff. So what this does is it repeals part of that and makes it so that a juvenile would go to juvenile court regardless of the crime. Okay, so it puts the power back in the hands of judges and takes it away from the prosecutors. We feel that this would be advantageous because a judge is supposed to have less bias than a prosecutor, can look at both sides of the story, can look at the child's full life before making the decision to then send them to adult court or not. So it's adding a little extra due process, repealing part of a Prop 21, and it's going to be very advantageous for youth. Another thing that Prop 57 does is it allows for nonviolent offenders in the state of California to be eligible for earlier parole if they take advantage of education courses, behavioral courses, and, you know, for example, GED. So we know that because if Prop 57 passes, immediately 30,000 people who are currently incarcerated would be affected, and 7,500 would be eligible for parole after. Why this is so important to me personally, my father is currently incarcerated, and he's taking family relations courses, so he would be one of the individuals who would be potentially eligible for earlier parole because of credits for taking these courses. So it incentivizes rehabilitation, which is what the system is supposed to do anyway. So just to recap, it protects you, right? It takes power away from prosecutors and gives it back to judges, and juveniles can be tried as juveniles. It also incentivizes rehabilitation in our system for people who are currently in lockup because they can get credits for those classes and good behavior.
Great, and so that's also one that NCJW is supporting, Prop 57. They're encouraging folks to vote yes on that one. Okay, Prop 58 is also an NCJW priority that they're supporting and encouraging all of us to vote yes. This is about bilingual education. Back in 1998, there was a ballot measure, Prop 227, which forced children in our public schools who don't already speak English into an English-only immersion track as how they would learn to speak English. This was back in the time when we were talking a lot about English as a national language and these kinds of movements that many groups representing immigrant communities and communities with English as a second language found very disturbing and very upsetting. This measure is going to repeal pieces of that and take us in a direction that's really going to assist children who are working hard to learn to speak English in our schools. So it gives parents a choice about which kind of educational environment is best for their child, whether they should be immersed into an English-only environment, or they should be in an environment where they're working with a teacher who speaks their language but is also teaching them English and teaching them the subjects they need to learn, you know, math, social studies, all of those other things. It allows a community to have, and parents to have input into the types of bilingual education that a school offers and what's best for that local community. And it also opens the possibility that if you have a child who speaks only English and they'd like to learn another language, they could also be part of these classes so that they could learn Spanish or Chinese or other languages. So this is seen as being beneficial to kids who don't yet speak fluent English, as well as fluent English speakers who want to learn and acquire additional languages.
Great idea.
So NCJW is strongly encouraging that you vote yes on Prop 58, which is better for bilingual education. Okay, the next one is Prop 59. This is the Citizens United ballot measure. Folks heard about this?
And the best haiku.
You think so? I'm not here for artistic critique, personally. This one has received a lot of press. There's been sort of a several-year-long effort around this. What it says is that we, as voters in California, believe that the legislature and the state government should do what they can to overturn Citizens United. See, I knew you knew this one. Now, Citizens United, you'll recall, is the Supreme Court decision, one of several Supreme Court decisions that really opened the floodgates to money in politics, to money in campaigns, and to allowing corporations to spend in unlimited ways. Now, so a lot of folks are in support of this, who want to see money out of our elections and want to see good campaign finance reform. The one caveat you should understand is that this will not really have a huge impact, because this ballot initiative basically conveys our desire to the state government of California that they do what they can to overturn Citizens United. The state government of California does not have the power to overturn the Supreme Court. Woe, but they did. On Citizens United. So it's certainly something that I would personally encourage you to vote yes on, but just understand that the consequences are limited. But it's important that we as Californians make our voices heard on the issue, right? Okay, Proposition 60. This is the ballot measure regarding pornographic films and the use of condoms in pornographic films. And you thought you were coming to a dry discussion about ballot measures. Now, this one is a little bit complicated. On the surface, it's about a policy question of should pornographic actors be required to wear condoms in pornographic films, and should the producers be required to make sure that that happens as a way to promote public health, lessen the spread of sexually transmitted infections, HIV, things like that. Now, many people who actually agree with that don't agree with this ballot measure because of how this measure is written and how it would be enforced. And it's quite complicated, but I'll share with you that Equality California, the leading LGBT advocacy organization in the state, is opposed. The LGBT Center here in Los Angeles is opposed. This is being supported by the AIDS Healthcare Foundation and Michael Weinstein, some of you may know, here in Los Angeles. So the concerns are around how it's enforced and how much power it gives to particular individuals. There are others who are concerned about that if you enforce these types of health requirements, then the pornographic films would simply go underground and be shot on the black market, I suppose. And that would actually put the performers at more risk. There are others who are concerned that this would mean that pornographic films would leave Los Angeles. There are others who would be very excited to see pornographic films leave Los Angeles. So there's various debates around the actual policy of requiring this type of public health measure, but even the folks who are in support of the public health measure, many of them have concerns about the structure of this initiative.
Plus litigation.
Litigation is one of the things they're very concerned about on this one.
Well,
Okay, Prop 61, another challenging one, I'd say. So what Prop 61 says is that when the state of California and its agencies are bargaining to buy prescription drugs, they're able to get them at the prices that the Veterans Affairs Agency, the federal VA, gets them at. The VA has great bargaining power. They get very cheap rates on prescription drugs, and this would allow California state agencies to get those same rates. Sounds good on the surface, right? Prescription drug rates are being hiked all over the place. It's a big concern. Now, some people believe that this could have adverse consequences, that this could mean that the rate would just end up being higher for the VA, and that our veterans would end up having less affordable access to prescriptions. Some believe that this might cause the drug companies to raise the cost of prescription drugs for everyone else to make up the difference. And the people who are actually covered by this California state agency provision, it's a fairly select and small group of folks, and so people on Medi-Cal, folks like that, might see rate increases. It's very challenging to figure out where you are on this one because it's hard to tell what the prescription drug companies are going to do in response to the regulation, and this is a first-in-the-nation type of effort. So I'll tell you that the nurses union is very much in support of it. The doctors are very much opposed to it. So you can see it's dividing folks. It's a challenging one. The state agency that currently does some of the prescription drug negotiations has said that they don't think that this will be a helpful measure, and there's some mixed data about whether or not they're actually paying more than the VA as it is. So this is one that it's very challenging. I don't mean to be unclear with you, but I just want to give you the arguments on both sides on some of these. Okay, Prop 62 and Prop 66 on the death penalty. Stephen is going to tell us all about them.
Thank you. It's so great to be back here. I always enjoy these programs. I wanted to thank Maya for the organizing, and it's always a pleasure to be introduced and participate with Ruth Zeitzer, a real heroine of mine. So I've got 10 minutes to cover these two propositions. You just want to walk away with yes on 62 and nix on 66. It's not haiku, but it's memorable. And this is, those positions are supported by this organization, as well as a broad spectrum of others, which I'll mention. Prop 62 is simple and straightforward. It would repeal the death penalty and convert the sentence to life in prison without possibility of parole, which we have now as an alternative to the death penalty. Over 3,000 people have received LWOP, life without parole, and none have ever been released. It keeps us safe and it keeps us humane. The death penalty has been abolished by over 140 countries. 20 states in America have abolished the death penalty. 4 more states have a moratorium on the death penalty. We are in league with China, Pakistan, Iran, and Saudi Arabia. And the United States is the 5th country that continues this barbaric form of punishment. 62 would end it. It would remove any chance of ever executing innocent people, which we fear has happened in this state and elsewhere. If you didn't care about that, but you cared about money, Prop 62 will save taxpayers $150 million a year. It is counterintuitive for some people, but it is far more expensive to have the death penalty. And that's the opinion of the independent legislative analyst, not just those of us who are against the death penalty. And 62 would increase to 60% prison earnings that people with life in prison use from their earnings of working to pay restitution and fines for their crimes. It's a straightforward initiative. It has the support of this organization, the League of Women Voters, the California Democratic Party, the National Democratic Party's platform seeks the abolition of the death penalty for the first time in its history. Fortunately, for my purposes today, each of you have a brochure on your chairs. Please take it with you, share it with your friends and family and colleagues, because it's packed with information about 62. I want to save a few minutes for 66. 66 would perpetuate, would double down on the death penalty. It is a highly deceptive, and I would say fraudulent initiative, because it makes false promises. We anticipate campaign advertising from the prosecutors and law enforcement who have paid to put Prop 66 on the ballot. It would do five things that would wreak havoc in our system. It would actually force appellate lawyers who currently do not take death penalty cases, who are on a special panel of appellate lawyers for all non-death penalty cases. It would say to those lawyers, you've got to take death penalty cases or be eliminated from the panel, which is their livelihood and their training. It would force untrained lawyers to defend men and women on death row. It will cause more litigation, more claims of ineffective assistance of counsel. As far as habeas corpus is concerned, turning this into a law school class, after all direct appeals are done, we have habeas corpus. You can come back into court if new evidence of your innocence has been discovered. You have state habeas and federal habeas. This Proposition 66 would send habeas corpus petitions, where they are now heard in the California Supreme Court, to the Superior Court in front of the same judge who just sentenced the person to death. It would require a new set of lawyers to be appointed by the Superior Court to handle these highly complex cases, and it provides no funding for this and doesn't disclose what county services would be taken away from us to fund it. And it would add two levels of appeal, because it would go from the Superior Court to the Court of Appeal to the Supreme Court. It will slow down these cases. It will make error more of a concern. Fourthly, it creates mini death rows for some unbelievable reason. This proposition requires the building of death rows around the state at an unprecedented, unknown cost, moving them away from San Quentin, where they're close to their appellate lawyers in San Francisco, and spread them around the state. I'm almost speechless, which is rare for me. Finally, it would clothe the lethal injection procedures that are now exposed to public scrutiny into secrecy, so the public would not know the procedures that are being proposed. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a dangerous proposition. If this was before the legislature in hearings where you could have public exposure, it wouldn't get out of committee. We fear that in a law and order mentality, it will try to appeal to people's worst fears. So it is yes on 62, nix on 66. President Obama a few days ago said, hope is on the ballot and fear is on the ballot. Well, hope is on the ballot with 62, fear is on the ballot with 66. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Now, something that is really important about 62 and 66, that Stephen will correct me if I'm wrong here, but my understanding is that it's really important that you vote on both of them, that you vote yes and no. If you were to only vote on 62 to repeal the death penalty, but you don't pay any attention to 66 and you just don't vote on it, and more people vote yes on that one than to repeal, then we would end up still having the death penalty.
So the highest vote count will go to the winner if they both pass. So we want to defeat 66, absolutely, but we want the highest number of votes for 62.
So it's very important that you tell folks they have to vote on both of them. Yes on 62, no on 66. And those are both NCJW encouraged positions, yes and no. Okay, Proposition 63, this is the gun violence prevention and gun safety provision, proposition that you may have seen some press about, heard some about. This is something that Lieutenant Governor Gavin Newsom is very heavily promoting. It's also a measure that NCJW has encouraged you to vote yes on Prop 63. Now, this has a number of different provisions. It has to do with further tightening the inability to have large capacity magazines, meaning lots of bullets being able to be shot all at once from a magazine on a gun. It also tightens up how folks can get their hands on ammunition, because a lot of times we regulate how you can get a gun, but we don't pay as much attention to regulating how you can get ammunition for that gun. This is really a combination issue. So this also tightens up how you can get ammunition in a number of ways. So this is a gun violence prevention measure, a gun safety measure. A number of the pieces of this are things that the state legislature did take some action on this year, but this just further tightens things up. Okay? NCJW encourages you to vote yes. Prop 64, this is the recreational marijuana legalization measure. So this is not about medical marijuana, this is about recreational use of marijuana. It's only for adults, it's not about children, it has a variety of provisions within it that say that it can't be used near a school, it can't be used when children are present, can't be used while driving a car. So the kinds of sort of common sense ways that you would want recreational use of marijuana to be regulated. It also allows local governments to have a say in some of these things. So that if a particular city wants to say, not only schools, but playgrounds, or we want it to be even farther away, there's ways for a local government to get involved and to tighten up those regulations even more if they wanted to. It also creates a tax on cultivating and sale of marijuana, and could potentially create quite a large amount of revenue for the state and for local governments from regulating the sale of recreational marijuana. The next proposition, the next two, are tied to each other. So this is Prop 65 and 67, and these are all about plastic bags. How many have heard about plastic bag things on the ballot? Okay, so like the death penalty, this is really important to understand how these two go together. That's why we have boxes around them on the haiku sheet, that understanding that they go together. So I'm going to start with Prop 67, because that's the easiest way to understand this. So skip over 65 for the moment and look at 67. Okay, 67 is about banning plastic bags. The kind of disposable plastic bags you get at a store, right? The really flimsy one that half the time they have to use two so they don't break. You know what kind of bags I'm talking about? Okay. So those plastic bags create an enormous amount of trash. And frequently they end up in our rivers, in our oceans. They have terrible consequences in terms of litter and also the consequences for wildlife and marine life. That get caught in them, that choke on them. They're an environmental hazard. We need to change our lifestyle and move toward the bags that we use over and over again, right? How many of you have those in the trunk of your car, the cloth bags? What a fantastic audience. So what this measure says is that those plastic bags can no longer be given out by stores for free. If they're going to give out, if they're going to give a bag, it needs to be a type of compostable, recyclable, more environmentally appropriate bag, and there needs to be a charge, a small charge for that type of bag. Okay? Now, people who are using like food stamps cards and things like that, they're not going to be charged that fee. So there's an appropriate attention to the concerns of folks who are low income. And the effort is to encourage all of us to move to cloth and reusable bags. So Prop 67 is the environmentally friendly effort to move us all away from these disposable plastic bags. So I would encourage you to vote yes on Prop 67. Okay? Now, Prop 65 was put on here by the plastic bag manufacturers. So you know that's good news, right? I should also say that Prop 67 actually includes also funding to train the workers and assist the businesses that make those plastic bags to transition them into making other types of bags that are not so environmentally harmful, which is very good. So Prop 65, the plastic bag makers basically put this on the ballot in order to confuse all of us. Because if you have two things about plastic bags on there, whatever will we do? So this one sounds like a good thing. It says that the fees that are charged for certain types of bags at grocery stores should go toward an environmental fund. And the funds would be used for things like cleaning up the beaches and the parks and good environmental projects. It sounds like a good thing. The problem is that they're trying legally to undo 67 by having 65 on here. They're also trying to punish the grocery store owners who are doing the right thing and supporting the environmental measure by taking this money out of their pockets. And they're just generally trying to confuse the public. There's also some problems with how this is written, that it might discourage folks from going to those compostable, reusable types of bags too. So my personal recommendation to you would be no on 65, yes on 67. That's the environmentally friendly way to go. No on 65, yes on 67. Okay, that brings us to the end of the statewide ballot of measures, but the fun is not over. Because we've got a few at the LA County, we've got a few LA City, there's even an LA Community College measure. You'll find these on the Haiku page. We're not going to cover all of these today, but Zach is going to tell us a little bit about just three of them. And before Zach starts into that, I just want to remind folks, if you have questions, write them on those cards. Maya is walking around and collecting them, okay, as well as Donna. So Zach, can you tell us about Measure M? Anyone who lives in Los Angeles County is going to see Measure M.
Does anyone remember, anybody remember Measure R a few years back? Okay, so Measure R was the, if you look on your Haiku page, let me help you guys.
It's on the back.
See this one? I'm holding it up. And it's on the back side. Turn around your Haiku. That's where they are. They're not in the back.
It sounds like maybe some people got a one-sided Haiku page. So we apologize for the confusion on that, but what you need to write down is Measure M, like
Mary.
Mary.
All right, so Measure M, it's one way to think about it is as extending on top of Measure R, extending our ability to fully fund the public transportation system for LA County, right? So it would allow us to do additional light rail, would allow us to do additional upgrades to Metrolink for those riders coming, for example, from San Bernardino, would allow us to do improvements for, like, we organize at a church in Baldwin Park and they're trying to build a, turn their area into a quiet zone with the Metrolink. It puts funding towards those types of projects as well, and also increases our ability to fund further rapid bus and other lines. It's a half cent sales tax, and it would be indefinite. So it would go, basically, once that money would fund initially the build out of the system, and then what it would do beyond that, and part of what Measure R didn't quite accomplish, is the money that we need for upkeep and maintenance of that system as we go forward.
So that's a good idea.
Exactly. This goes on top of the sales tax that we currently have in the county. It doesn't replace Measure R. I'm sorry?
So our sales tax cap is 9.75,
so we do 10.25 if this passes. That's correct. And I don't know which of those other sales taxes that are on the ballot now sunset at some point, so I can't tell you what the fluctuation will be like 5 years from now, what it will go down to. But this one will not go away. We support it. A lot of the grassroots organizations in the county support it. We know, just for example, to speak of one of the Jewish communities that I know that's working very hard to pass this is Leo Beck Temple. Okay?
It's pretty regressive tax, though.
some inefficient.
Do you want me to move to H now?
Yes.
What's your recommendation?
Okay.
Yes.
My recommendation is yes, on behalf of LA Voice and Zach Hoover, but I don't know if there's a recommendation.
There's not a recommendation from NCJW, but I strongly agree with supporting this one, personally.
It's also a pollution reduction plan, basically, for our county, because it gets more of us out of our lives. Okay, I know we're going to have questions. We're going to have questions.
Write the questions down on the card.
I got to get through two more.
Zach's now going to talk us.
In 7 minutes.
Talk us through LA City Measure HHH. If you live in the city of LA proper, HHH.
Okay, how many of you have noticed in the last few years that homelessness visibly has gotten worse? Raise your hand. We all know it's true. The numbers tell us the same thing. There are more than 26,000 people now homeless in our city, and homelessness in Los Angeles went up 11% last year alone. So I'd like to start with the why on this one, and the number of people living in encampments, which is what you and I see, is up 20%. So we have an incredible problem we have to deal with. We also know what works. There's been a focus on veterans homelessness, and while these numbers have gone up with the focus on veterans homelessness, it's actually dropped. I can't remember the percentage, but it's an incredible amount. And within the next 12 to 18 months, they anticipate getting close to what's considered a functional zero. So we know it works. This really is a money problem. And there's two parts to it. And I'm gonna say something about the county, but if you're in the city, if you're voting yes on Proposition HHH, then basically what you're voting for is a $1.2 billion bond that over 30 years will allow nonprofit affordable housing developers, the city doesn't build housing, affordable housing developers do, to get funds to build projects that are supportive housing for, particularly for chronically homeless folks. There's also a portion of that money that can go to people in very low income housing, 20% of the total funds, which for an organization like us with people who are on the edge of homelessness is really important, so more people aren't falling into homelessness as their wages decline compared to cost of living or their rents go up. So let's see, if you have $1 million home, just to give you like an average of what the cost is gonna be, for people whose home is worth $1 million, which is not me, but it's $171 a year at its peak over the 30-year period, and in its lowest period, it's only $40 a year. So if your home is worth less than that, then you're gonna fluctuate at a smaller level than that. So please write down your question. But basically, what happens is over 30 years, it goes like this: costs you a little more in the middle, and costs you less at the beginning and the end. Right. So if your home is worth $1 million. In the beginning and at the end, you're paying around $40 a year on your parcel to cover this bond, and in the middle of it, you know, 15 years from now, it's $171 a year. So we definitely think this needs to pass, and then the county is working on something for March that will provide the concomitant services, because housing without services is not a full program, and the county and the city are amazingly doing a lot of coordination together. So I know I took a little extra time on this one, but I think it's both, it's simple, yet there's a complexity in terms of the county and city working together. We gotta pass this, guys. We have to pass this, okay? Jay.
JJJ.
All right, JJJ.
And this is for LA City, if you live in the city of LA.
Thank you.
JJJ.
Also LA City. We're a yes on JJJ. To keep it brief, in addition to the homelessness crisis, there's also a housing crisis. And there's challenges with wages. Even though many of us on this panel have worked to get wages increased, a lot of our folks still aren't making enough to afford the housing that they have lived in for many years or they would like to live in. So what Jay does, it's not a tax, what Jay does is it says, if you're a private developer and you want to build within a half mile radius of Metro, it incentivizes some of the things that developers tend to ask for. Like, they might say, I really want less parking here, or I want to be able to build a building higher, or this was zoned for commercial and I'd like to put units here where people can live in. For example, downtown, there might be something that's commercial and they want to build condos, or they want to build affordable, or they want to build rental units. And what JJJ does is it says, if you're going to get those things, which right now many developers get in exchange for no affordable housing and no jobs requirements, you're gonna need to include a percentage of the development as affordable housing, or put it in a trust fund that we can spend on building affordable housing. Secondly, It makes them prevailing wage jobs for construction, which basically means wages that are comparable with union wages. And then third, there's targeted local hire. And this for us is one of the most important ones. So people who are formerly incarcerated, formerly homeless, from high poverty zip codes, there's a significant percentage, I think it's almost 30% of the jobs that are need to go to those, or that are targeted toward communities that are significantly disadvantaged. So LA Voice is a yes on J. These guys are a yes, you all are a yes on J, right?
Is NCJW in a position?
Yep.
Yeah.
And
tell us how it relates to the measure that will be on the city ballot next year, which I hear it was a response to.
Yeah, hopefully this one gets a higher vote count than that one does, because that one would basically kill development.
That's kill mega development.
That's right.
So let's just use the cards for stuff, folks.
Yeah. So I'm out of time.
Okay, thank
yes,
you
I'm
so
JJ.
Much, Zach.
They get enough wages to develop.
All right, folks. Use your cards if you have comments or questions. All right, so we have a number of questions that have come up. I'm going to try to run through them and keep them roughly in order, and hopefully it clarifies anything that wasn't quite clear. So the first two questions are on Prop 51. So this is the very first one we talked about. And this one is about the money for school construction and school remodeling. So the questions are, what is Governor Brown's suggestion instead of Prop 51? He doesn't have a particular proposal that he's pushing instead. There's lots of things that could be done, but he just doesn't particularly like this one. And the related question is, how could we get funding distributed into more lower income areas for those schools? There's lots of different things that could be done, but there's not a competing measure right now. So I think what we could all do if this passes is try to assist and encourage low-income schools to get those applications in. If any of you are grant writers, I'm sure they'd appreciate your help. Okay, that's Prop 51. I don't think we got any questions on Prop 52, so moving on to, actually here's one on Prop 52. Can or will the hospitals raise fees to cover the fees to go toward the Medi-Cal? We don't think that they will, because this is an existing fee that would just be continuing. So it shouldn't cause prices to go up if we continue what's happening currently. Okay, Prop 53. Zach, I don't have any specifically for you that I don't already know the answer to.
Please pardon me. Thank
Zach
you so
is
much.
A busy guy.
Thank you, Zach.
Thank you, Zach. Okay, the next question is on Prop 53. This is the one about high-speed rail and the Delta tunnels. And the question is, what are the other kinds of projects that this could impact other than those two? So because it has to be a revenue bond that is over $2 billion, it's not going to impact a ton of infrastructure. Those have to be really big projects. But the kinds of things they could be are things that we might need to respond to environmental disasters, things that we might need to prevent fires. So the firefighters are opposed to Prop 53 for this reason. So it's going to be infrastructure, public safety kinds of things, bridges, tunnels, big public works projects. Okay. Proposition 54. This is the 72-hour requirement. We got two questions on this, and I think we also had a question from the audience about it, so I think I wasn't as clear as I needed to be on this one. So what this says is that the language of the bill has to be stable, set, written in stone for 72 hours before the legislature votes on it. The full assembly or the full Senate before they have their vote. So there cannot be any amendments or tweaks or changes during those 72 hours. If somebody wants to amend or tweak or change something, the clock starts over again. And they have to have another 72 hours before they can have the vote. Now, because our legislature has deadlines in its process, for example, anything that's not passed by midnight at the last day of August is just done for the year. So they're going to have it figured out 3 days before that deadline, right? So The good, the argument for why this would be a positive thing is that it helps all of us to know exactly what's being voted on, what the bill says. You got 3 days of having it online to look at it, to think about it, to contact your legislator. What folks argue about why this would be a problem is that that means that legislators have a tougher time coming together and coming up with a deal that brings people together who are on opposite sides of an issue, and coming up with a deal and having that deal stick until it passes, right? Because there's 3 days for the lobbyists who don't like this part or don't like this part to peel off legislators, to peel off the votes. Does that make sense? Okay, so those are the two arguments about that that proposition. Okay. Prop 55, I think we had a question about, right, Rosemarie?
Yes, we did. The question is the $250,000 being raised to, for example, $500,000? Because $250,000 isn't so much anymore. So $250,000 is for a single income earner. So if you're a single person who files taxes singly, then the $250,000 applies to you. It's not being raised. It's continuing what's already on the books. So if you are a family, if you are married and you file taxes jointly, then the bar is actually at $500,000. Starts at $500,000. And I would argue, you know, if $250,000 isn't so much anymore, I think you're very fortunate, very blessed, and I'm very glad you feel that way. But actually, in LA, it's LA City specifically, about a quarter of the people don't make 15 right now. They make under 15, and 80% of them are experiencing some type of wage theft. And I come from those communities, and so $30,000 a year is a lot. To a lot of people, to about a quarter of the population right now. So this would significantly help by having you know, people who make a little bit more pay a bigger share, or their fair share.
Yes, fair share.
Okay, the next question actually is for Zach, and I'm not sure. What amount or percent of funds actually go to tobacco-related cancer research on the cigarette tax one? Does anyone have the answer to that? Okay.
2%?
I believe it's around
2%. Okay, Rosemarie thinks that it's 2% go to tobacco-related cancer research from the tobacco tax, but the money goes into healthcare as well. So this is, research is one specific part of it, but others, it's funding for healthcare, for awareness campaigns.
I have a little bit of a breakdown. So 82% of the money actually goes directly to healthcare. And a portion of that would go to Medi-Cal. So 82%, about $1.4 billion, would go directly into those services. A smaller portion, I believe it's around 11%, so if I'm off by a percent or two, forgive me, goes to prevention programs for youth. So directly into education and prevention for youth, and then the remainder goes into the cancer research.
Okay, and do you know the answer to this one, Rosemarie? Will cigarettes brought in from out of state be taxed too? How, and what about the ones you buy on the internet?
That's a great question. I'm not sure I thought any cigarettes sold would be...
My strong suspicion is that this will be handled the same way any other goods brought in from out of state or on the internet are sold, and that tobacco wouldn't be different from stereos and sweaters and everything else, but that's something to double check. But a good place to look for a lot of really detailed information on these is to look at the voter guide that's sent out, so you'll be getting that in the mail. You can also look on Ballotpedia. Ballotpedia has a lot of good information and links to a lot of other places about these measures.
A little bit of a funny story. We did signature gathering for this particular initiative in South LA and got 15,000 people to actually sign up and then say yes, they were going to vote for it. A lot of them smokers because they thought they would be using the healthcare system later in life, so they wanted to pay it forward, was what we were hearing. So I thought that was really interesting. We were
very rational. Okay, on number 57, which is one of yours, can the folks who are currently incarcerated or on parole still help as firefighters?
You know what, I'm not sure. That's a very specific question. Could they still help as firefighters as they're still in lockup?
Yeah, I think there's currently a program in the state prisons where some people who are deemed to be very safe and qualify on good behavior and things like that are able to help fight fires. So I don't think that this would impact it, but
it's not removing
sure.
any programs. It's actually adding more programs. It's adding more family relations courses, GED courses, drug rehab courses inside the system.
I just kind of a partial response to that, and I'm guessing that the person who asked the question, stand so I can be heard better, read the same article, an article in the Times just yesterday or the day before that talked about the fact that with the early release of nonviolent crimes, we're seeing less and less available prisoner resources that are utilized as firefighters. So I'm not saying that that's good or bad on the whole, but it is a problem for the state.
I would rather my dad be home than but I see that's a really good point. I mean, it's a necessary service, right? And I know a lot of people taking these programs get a lot out of them.
So maybe we have to transition that program to somebody other than balance, like maybe homeless or low-income people that don't have career paths, job paths today.
Yeah, I think that's great.
Yep, lots of things we can talk about to supplement firefighting forces.
And then I have another one. What constitutes a nonviolent crime under Prop 57? This is a great question, and I would encourage you to read the language. It's pretty straightforward language. You can find it on the California government's website. So this does not explicitly state what is violent or nonviolent. It actually relies on existing penal code and existing statutes to define what's violent and nonviolent. So it's not changing anything. So there's a rumor going around, and I've read many articles saying that certain violent crimes, for example, raping somebody while they're unconscious, would become nonviolent under this. I think that's absolutely not true. And actually, they provided a rebuttal. So the governor's office is in support of Prop 57 and has provided a rebuttal and actually states the penal code that wouldn't be affected by this. So people are doing their homework, and it's only going to get uglier. So the people that are opposing this particular initiative happen to be law enforcement, the California Republican Party, not LAPD. LAPD supports this. We know that it's going to affect us deeply in LA County, and they're ready to vote yes on this. But other law enforcement across the state is against it, and you just have seen some really ugly headlines around it. But I want to remind you that this is affecting juveniles and nonviolent offenders. We have to remember that people are human, and sometimes they make bad decisions, but they're not bad people.
Thank you. Okay, the next question is regarding Proposition 58. This is the bilingual education one. And the question is, how are parental preferences implemented annually, periodically, et cetera? So there's two parts to this. Number one is that Prop 58 would allow parents to have a decision-making power about their own child, what type of classroom they're in, whether they're in a bilingual classroom, an immersion classroom, what was going to work best for their child. So that's a pretty concrete, that you get to have a say over your own child. I'm not sure, I'd have to look in detail whether that's, you know, once a year or when those preferences can be made. The other aspect is the community input from parents and an entire community about what that school is going to offer. So there's two ways that parental input is given, and I'm not sure of the timeline. I'm not sure that the timeline is actually specified in the ballot initiative. It may be. Okay, Prop 59 on Citizens United. The question was whether or not other states are doing this. So there are a lot of different efforts around the country to address overturning Citizens United. I'm not sure if another state has it on their ballot, but there are lots of different states who are passing things in their state legislature, things like that. So there's a national effort of various types to try to overturn Citizens United. I'd like to thank you all for not submitting questions on Prop 60 so that I don't have to continue on that. Okay, Prop 61, I don't think I got questions on. Prop 62, which is the death penalty. So first question is, how will it save over $160 million per year to repeal the death penalty?
Figures $150 million a year. Death penalties in this state cost a lot of money. You have to have a two-stage trial at the very beginning, a guilt phase, whether the defendant's guilty or not, and a penalty phase. You also may have a sanity phase, and in all of it, you have jury selection. In the death penalty area, these are huge, time-consuming trials. Records often are 1,000 pages just for jury selection in a criminal trial. And usually the state is paying both sides of that. They are paying the state prosecutors and the public defenders. Huge expense in that regard. You have an appeal to the California Supreme Court. These are such big records, they have carts they wheel down the hall at the Supreme Court because the record is so extensive. Expert witnesses are called by both sides in both phases of the trial and have to be paid for. Then you have death row itself, which have individual cells, high security in San Quentin. Every independent study, including the legislative analyst, has put that number at $150 million more to pursue the death penalty than to put someone in prison for the rest of their natural life.
Thank you so much. Okay, another question.
What about the cost to keep them in prison for the rest of their life?
There's a cost to keep them in prison, but it's less.
This is a net savings above that cost.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So this person wanted to clarify how 62 and 66 cancel each other.
All right. If 62 wins and 66 loses, it's over. 62 prevails.
And that means the death penalty is ended for California.
Right. If both pass, then you have to look at the raw votes of both of them. You could have a percentage of smaller votes, and 66, which is later in the ballot, could pass. But the raw number of yes votes for 66 passing is greater than the raw votes of 62 passing. That's just mathematical. So the question at the end of the day, which proposition has the more raw yes votes if they both pass? The constitutional challenges to 66 are abundant. 66 itself could be in the courts for years. I didn't mention it tells the Supreme Court it has to decide death penalty cases within an absolute period of 5 years. The current average is 15 years. You can't tell a court it has to decide someone's life or death within a limited number of years. So the challenges to 66 will be great. It could later be found unconstitutional. And the best lawyers, I don't know if Sandra has an answer for this, if 62 has passed and 66 has more votes and is later found unconstitutional, will that reinstate 62 and end the death penalty? It's
Let's
a nightmare.
Never find out.
It's a nightmare. Yes on 62, no on 66.
Okay. Skipping back up for a moment to questions on 58. How many languages will be offered? The languages that are offered, I think, are going to depend on what school you're talking about, whether it's in a community where a lot of Chinese or Mandarin is spoken, or if it's a community where a lot of Spanish is spoken. So that's really going to depend on school to school. Question about Prop 61, which is the one about drug prices. Why can't the state agencies negotiate with pharmaceutical companies the way the VA does? They do negotiate with them now. The situation is that there are different prices being negotiated with the state agencies than with the VA. Some think that those prices for the state agencies are higher, some think that they're not. This is an effort to try to have them be as low as the VA, but again, the challenge on this one is that we're not sure that this would actually lower prices for everyone generally. It might cause prices to go up depending on which group of folks you fall into. I should say that pharmaceutical companies are spending a lot of money to convince us not to vote for this. That might be indicative of what their opinion is. Okay, Proposition 63, which is about purchases of ammunition and large capacity magazines. Can you still buy them over the internet? You know that one, Maya? So we'll have to look into that one further. And Prop 64, would this mean less illegal growing of marijuana? Yes, that's the hope, is that folks would stop doing this underground in illegal ways and instead get permits and do it in a
To do it underground if they're planning.
A little ballot measure humor. Okay. Prop 64, will medical marijuana be taxed? Prop 64 doesn't change medical marijuana. It's only about the recreational side. Can you, Are there a lot of pot smokers in the audience? I have a lot of questions about the federal pot legislation. Can you only have X amount of grams in possession? Yes, that's how it works. There's a specific amount that you're allowed to have in possession. More than that would still be illegal. Okay. How have Colorado, Oregon, Washington, Alaska, D.C. fared with tax revenue since legalization? Given that pot remains illegal federally, pot shop income reporting still doesn't happen. It's a cash business. So they've seen tax revenues coming in those states, but it is very complicated because of the federal government's position. So generally, the thinking of folks who are in favor of legalizing recreational marijuana is that we keep moving forward and working with the federal government, and that eventually there will be reform at the federal level, and that will make it all a lot simpler, but that moving forward at the state level is one of the steps that will get the federal government there. And this measure would address a lot of the issues with the cash nature of the business and their inability to pay taxes in anything other than cash. So this would help, but not entirely solve those problems. Okay, Prop 65 and 67, about the bags. Does this include bags from department stores or just grocery stores? So these kinds of plastic bags, it applies to like bags in any kind of store, but there are exemptions for the little bags you get on the roll at the produce counter that you pull and you put a bunch of grapes in them. It doesn't impact those. It doesn't impact bags for meat and for bulk foods if you're like buying like a whole bunch of peanuts in a bag or something like that. So there are exemptions for things like that, but other than that, it's not specific to where you're getting the bags. What about plastic bags? One puts fruits and vegetables in. Exactly. Same question? Okay. So we've got a couple of questions about the local measures that Rosemarie is going to handle.
So the first one, let's stick with HHH and JJJ. Is HHH all funded by property taxes? Yes, it is funded through bonds that would be gained through property tax on both homeowners and commercial property. So it is an additional tax. That was the next question that we had. But it's based on the value of your home. And so what I've been hearing, the rhetoric, is that if you have a home that's worth less than $1 million, you will pay at most $40. If your home is worth more than that, then it can go up to $171. And it would raise potentially $1.2 billion over the lifetime of the bond.
That's $40 per year?
It's per year. That is per year.
For 30 years?
Whatever the length of HHH changes, 30 years. JJJ, who does oversight? The City Planning Commission would be doing oversight. They currently do oversight on development now. I've spoken to a few commissioners, and they are actually overwhelmingly in favor of this. It's really hard to get developers to care about affordable housing, and so this would give them the protection that they don't have currently on the board to require more affordable housing. So who does oversight? The City Planning Commissioner. Now I'm going into Measure M. Sales taxes, I don't know if this is a question. Sales taxes are aggressive and hurt the poor. Is there an alternative? There isn't a current alternative right now. I will say that there are quite a few groups staying neutral on this, particularly the groups that work with low-income communities on transit issues. But there are others who say that they believe that equity can be built in or new projects can be promoted after this is passed. So it is a regressive tax. There is no alternative right now. There's another statement slash question. Seeing that $120 billion is at stake related to Measure M, it is obvious that a transit measure will go to the ballot every 2 years. Shouldn't we get it right rather than vote for this contractor-driven measure which slashes bus service and is not the most efficient use of our funds? That's a pretty loaded question. You know, what it is going to be promoting a lot of projects that happens to be rail-focused. I will say that looking at the plans now. There's another question about who determines what gets built. Metro Board determines what gets built. They do the research, they do analysis. That doesn't mean that the community doesn't have any say. Community has worked, for example, with them around the Crenshaw line, whether for good or for bad, with the board ultimately determines what gets built. So should we wait for something that's not so contractor driven? I'm not sure. I think that's
something that we can't really answer. It doesn't focus on bus service, that is true, although they are hoping to use some of the increased funding to reduce bus fares and to give discounts to seniors and to students again. More discounts or free passes, that's what's in the language.
Okay, thank you, Rosemarie. All right, we've got a couple of general questions. How do voters know if funds allocated will in fact go to the entities that they're meant for? Well, if it is specified in the ballot measure where funding goes, like that it goes to building schools, renovating schools, or that it goes to healthcare, then that is a legal requirement. So that's part of the law, just like any other law that we've passed. Ballot measures are actually some of the strongest in our inability to change them. So I think you can feel assured that if it says in the ballot measure where the funding goes, that's where it's going to go. What is the website that discloses financial funding of ballot measures? Ballotpedia has a lot of great information about who is funding the campaigns, yes and no, and you can see that the bag manufacturers are behind it, or the pharmaceutical companies, etc. There's also information on Cal Access, which is the state's government website, but that is much harder to navigate. There's information on Power Search, is another good website, but I think Ballotpedia is probably your best bet.
State's website should have the state measures.
Yes, it does. It's just hard to navigate. So Ballotpedia has the state ones, and that's a great source. And I think we'll close on this. Why isn't the legislature voting on these issues? The citizens are doing the work of the legislature. Well, it's a complicated issue. So some of these ballot measures, like the one on bilingual education, the legislature actually referred to the voters. Others, like the one on gun safety, the legislature wanted to handle, but someone wanted it to be on the ballot. Lieutenant Governor Gavin Newsom really wanted it to be on the ballot. Other times, it's an idea like the one about the Delta water tunnels. It's an idea by one particular individual citizen who wants to spend millions of dollars to put their idea forward. So there's lots of pluses and minuses to our ballot measure system, and folks have lots of different opinions about it, but the legislature's role in it is as varied as the number of ballot measures that are on there. Usually the legislature is trying to work on lots of these issues, and this year they did have success in negotiating with the proponents of a number of ballot measures to keep them off the ballot, to have the legislature take action instead. So the members of the legislature are pretty soundly in support of having fewer ballot measures.
Sandra?
Yes?
Can I have a final word?
One final word, yes you may.
Education on this death penalty seems to be the answer. The more people know about 62 and 66. I've got business cards here. If you're part of a synagogue, mosque, church, community organization, and can bring together an audience like this, I'd be more than happy to come out and speak with you. Thank you.
Do folks feel less confused than when they got here?
Yes, thank you.
Thank goodness. Thank you for coming.